going to look in the scenario in which the Russian Empire reunites. Why is Alaska colored in? Because, well, they have Alaska. And yeah. And no, this is not Alaska becoming the Russian Empire. Well, as we can tell, Russia's pretty strong looking now as a Russian Empire. But Russia still exists. A non-Russian Russia. And yeah, they become the big guy. This may not be completely accurate borders, but as well, I made them for it. And yeah. They're strong. They have all of Alaska, so I bet they have dominance in North America if they want to attack Canada, which I doubt. But there's an ongoing war with Ukraine. Why am I continuing it with this video, even though Ukraine is just Lviv? Because we can. And yeah. The Russian Empire, with millions of other people, just send forces in. And yeah. As their forces move in, they sweep in to Ruthenia areas. Well, they take over this area of Ukraine. And they decide to make this a direct part of their empire. Now they're starting to expand, with them deciding to go after the Baltics. Parts that must be a part of it, to be Russia even. And yeah, they go for it. They don't even hesitate. About making sure the people like them. With Poland now seeing the brunt of this aggressive expansion as they declare war on Poland, but Germany, stating for their own interests, decide to go to war with Poland to protect their borders. Secure their borders is what they say. Which maybe it's true, but I think they're just going to annex it, maybe. Most people think, well, there is a document between these two nations. And well, when German forces enter Poland, they basically just march in. With a huge Polish minority in the Russian Empire. This actually is fixing these bad borders I now gave it. And yeah. As they march in, they even start a frontier. Well, Warsaw is a part of them. And yeah. Germany isn't moving as fast, but that's mostly because, well, the Russian Empire should be stronger than them. Maybe the Russian Empire is going to lose to Japan in the Russo-Japanese War. Yeah, they did kind of do that. Which Germany takes out these lands and treats them being split between where the front lines were at the end of the war. But little does Germany know, what they have done has enabled an evil nation. With them going to war with everyone on their eastern front, almost everyone. Sweden is scared because last time Sweden fought a Russian Empire, it didn't go so well for Sweden. And they were neutral after, I guess. Maybe. With them crossing in this front, with Bulgaria just and Serbia basically joining Russia's team. Why are they invading everyone? Because they can. And yeah, Russia's doing Slavic Brotherhood again. With them crossing in into more over in Moldova, they cross from here. Serbia crosses into Hungary. And Serbia crosses into Romania, along with Bulgaria. With Russia starting a front here, managing to get there with this happening. Just as they expect, they encircle the capital of Slovakia, and they take it as they can. Bratislava, they took. And now they head into Hungary, deep into Hungary's interior. This happening. And that noise is a snowblower in the background, sadly. And yeah. And then they take Budapest. With Hungary living their last breath as they die. And Romania could make peace, but why would they if they're... Well, Bucharest gets surrounded and taken by the Bulgarians, with looking bad for Romania, personally, I think. But Romania is still fighting. Eventually, a bunch of just pockets left. As they are taken out, and guerrilla fighting continues. But they sign a peace treaty. Why do they sign a peace treaty? Because they need a divide of its own. But one of the most shocking is an invasion of Mongolia. One of the largest scale wars ever taken by them so far in this video. And why do I feel like an alliance is going to form against them? But this isn't the war. With somehow Vladimir Putin is found in the front lines. Why? Because there's a monarch. And with them taking another front. But Mongolia just says, yeah, we can just keep having our life. But let's say they decide this Russian Empire is also not very friendly to anyone. Especially not China. With them now headed for Ulaanbaatar, which they managed to encircle and take. But Mongolia doesn't surrender. Nobody fights. They just say, yeah, we'll keep Mongolia alive as long as we can. They basically say to Russia, yeah, we're not going to fight you, but we're not going to give you our land. So basically, Russia has to push into the land, which is a waste of resources because it's a debt between two barren wastelands, I guess you could say. Does Mongolia have mountains? They probably do somewhere. With the rest of Mongolia falling to Russian hands. With the Russians just... Well, maybe I did. With Germany meeting with France in Berlin, they decide to form an anti-Russian pact. Which many countries decide to join. France and Germany found it. Sweden is thinking of joining it. Officially states that has interest in joining, but doesn't officially join yet. With Canada saying, yeah, I think we need to join something to protect us. America agrees, but Canada basically says, yeah, Alaska is ours. And America's like, why? We had it first. Because, well, I'm going to take it over when Russia attacks us, is what Canada states. And Benelux says, yeah, we're joining. Britannica rules waves, they all say. With us being known as the Berlin Pact. South Korea and Japan both join. Sweden says, yeah, we have interest in joining this anti-Russian pact. But Russia hears it, and for some reason... They choose a new king. Why do they get a new emperor? Because they decide they want better person for it. With them making a naval attack here and then near Stockholm. With Sweden saying, we still have interest. But unfortunately, what they have to do is fight back the Russians to their border, which... Do you really think Russia will back up? No. With them getting pushed out in the south, and it looks like they're going to get pushed back in the north. Their objective is to snake down the coast. And take the northern lands, but Sweden has kicked them back. with Sweden deciding to attack in a different front, trying to get up to the Finnish area. Yeah. With Sweden having major success, except the problem is Gotland, a very strategic point, and this island is militarized because it was a part of the Russian Empire. Russia uses it to get into Sweden. And then they push down Stockholm. They take Stockholm. I don't know if that's the right location of Stockholm. And yeah. The Swedish military is fighting on the longest front ever. With places like Denmark and Norway joining against Russia. Why? Because they see what will happen if they decide to take their time in joining. They know Russia will do something. Russian troops are accused on the Chinese border of shooting, which they reject. And Iran accuses them of attacking them. But they say, no, we didn't. And yeah, Russia does the most crazy annexation scheme. They annex these lands just in case the thing leaves, just so they can get there. And then they annex up the coast here. Then to give Stockholm room, they annex here. And things happen. As Russia said, we are not planning to invade Iran, despite having troops building up in Azerbaijan, Armenia, and the Caucasus. They had them in Turkmenistan built up. And yeah, all these forces are called to the front line, suddenly and randomly. Why would you attack Iran, one of your former allies? With the anti-Russian pact sending resources to Iran. And yeah, they have loads of forces in Turkmenistan ready to cross. But they also made a convoy headed towards Tehran, which they move to. The Battle of Tehran breaks out, they win. But as they are having success right now, this is where the forces start moving in. But Russia didn't securely take Tehran yet, so Iran manages to take back Tehran. But how long do you really think they'll keep it? With Russia somehow invading mountains, let's be honest, how do you do that, Russia? I think there's like flat ground all in the center. If I'm wrong, yeah, I probably am. With Iran in a bad spot. But Iran decides to take a counter-offensive where the less equipped, well-equipped troops are in this region. Which they do so successfully. But that's at the time where the West is now split on two fronts. They attack... What did they just do? They attack China. But as we know, nobody realized... Everybody knew they were building troops up in the Xinjiang border. They finally cross. But they also had them in the Mongolia border. And, well, they were mostly planned for taking Manchukuo for some reason. And they... Well. But that's not the only place they're fighting. They're also fighting in Iran. With a lot of aid having to go to two countries now, Iran starts disappearing. And yeah, they do this. They spearhead under Tehran. With them doing the second attack on Tehran, which this was after somehow some Vladimir Putin decided to get back in power. Weird how he got back. Maybe you went to military training. Gotta be an emperor. But he overthrew it with his friends. Maybe that makes sense. And, well, Iran just stays like that. Doing nothing. With it looking like China might be doing bad on one front, but in Manchukuo they managed to kick the Russians out. Which isn't a surprise. Do you really think China would be able to lose? No. Russia really wanted Manchukuo, but it doesn't look like they're getting it. With them also being kicked back in Mongolia front. And a lot of things happen as Russia sends most of its forces to the Xinjiang, into Xinjiang. Everybody can tell what they're trying to do, annex Xinjiang. Which they deny, but that's what they're trying to do. With Iran agreeing to peace. Which peace is not really nice to them. Puppeting the South and annexing down to this border. Making this Iranian-Russian border. This is unfair, but at least they keep Tehran. And then they force the rest of Iran subjugate into a puppet state, which many of the bordering nations despise. And nations such as Iraq join this alliance, or Syria, Lebanon, Pakistan, Israel, wait, what? Saudi Arabia joins, even. India joins. But this is where Russia is starting to get close to having to fully counter these nations. With China trying to get other nations to join this war, which isn't really working. With Russia's front being really long. With the Russian force not really knowing, thinking that the border is, with India basically being here, they think that the area China claims is theirs is somehow shown on a map. But Indian forces shoot at them, in which Russia responds with firing back, which they fired on Indian forces. With them getting fired back on, they enter south. Thinking that that was Chinese forces, which was a big mistake, because it wasn't. And they have brought India into this war, which was a horrible decision on their part. But luckily, they have the strongest navy in the world somehow. They have a good chance of winning. In some fronts, but not all. Like, I think they'll win in Norway. Well, I know they would. But I know they wouldn't in one front. Isn't good. Well, with this happening, well, there is reason why countries like China and India might now be a problem in their back. And yeah. This is what the border looks like as they invade the mountains in the Xinjiang. No, not Xinjiang. This is Kashmir. With Indian and Pakistani forces fighting on the same front. That's weird. But it makes sense. With Russia starting its second offensive in the Manchukuo. With Japan finally in South Korea getting the message they were supposed to declare war, which they didn't. Somehow Russia had communications down. With Australia and New Zealand joining the war. Czechia decides to join the war. Along with Austria. And they kind of get Albania and Kosovo to join their side. And Italy basically says sure. Along with Spain and Portugal. But Russia wasn't ready on this front. But they quickly get their forces ready. After Germany starts and everybody starts an assault. With especially Germany. Oh my god, we did something wrong. And now we're doing it right, with Germany taking a huge offensive in, along with Albania managing to push forth, and Turkey manages to. With them even managing to attack in the puppet states of Hungary and Slovakia. And them taking these puppets out, and they start a humongous offensive, with Russia managing to stall them out. What does Russia do? So they have trouble getting oil? Well, they make a smart move, which is an invasion of Norway. Especially with them making good progress in the Norway, but Germany starts moving forces up to Norway, which makes a lot of land start falling to the Russia, to the Russians. As they approach on the German border. And yeah, they continue their kicking out of the world's forces there. But they have one problem, and that is going to bite them. Iran. With the Iranian puppet still being a lot of people who despise Russia. And yeah, even Russia still hasn't officially annexed. With them finally annexing these lands. Oh, okay. With the progress here being bad for them. Them and Manchukuo actually doing good as they're starting to take lands. Well, I'm moving from Valvalvi stock to protect it. How is China losing to them? Because they're probably the strongest nation in the world at this time. And they continue, even in North America, fighting happens. And it stalemates in all of Asia. Kick Russia out of Alaska. Oof, Russia, that must hurt hard. With Russia starting a offensive into Germany. This is to secure Poland gains. And they push into Austria and Czechia. With Norway's capital of Oslo falling. Within weeks after Oslo falls, this happens. And yeah. Oslo falls. With Denmark then getting invaded. Oh no. And yeah. With in Iran, that's still fighting is happening. But in China, fighting starts changing as Pakistan, India, and China round for a counter-offensive. And yeah. But Russia manages to keep them from taking lands back as they push them back. They're trying to keep over Xinjiang rule, which people in Xinjiang start revolting to help them. Why do they revolt? Well, there's probably many reasons. Oppression and other things that have been going on in this region of the world. I don't know what it is, but something's going on. And Xinjiang basically falls to Russian forces, which they managed to hold on to. I don't know why. It's not like these people would want to fight for Russia. With Manchukuo's front going good until it doesn't, as China teams up with Japanese forces to attack Manchuria, which Japan attacks outer Manchuria and inner Manchuria fighting happens between China and Russia. With Sakhalin being where the first fighting happens, and Japan quickly takes it. And well, the Russian Empire does not like this. But what are they going to do about it? Says some people. This happens. Looks like America is going to China. And Chinese forces meet up with Japanese. They're working together somehow. South Korean forces are helping too. With this happening, front line of China becomes this. But to China's detriment, they lose a big chunk of land. Well, in Bulgaria and Serbia, blue team forces are kicked back. Especially Turkey's forces. But what Russia doesn't realize is that they were gearing for a different offensive. Into Azerbaijan and Armenia. Oh no, not Armenia. Please tell me Turkey doesn't do what they did the last time they did this. And yeah, a puppet state here gets invaded on multiple fronts. And yeah, Israel is trying to free Iran. Never thought I would think of that. To help with the liberation as they enter near Baku, they take Baku. There's a lot of oil in this area of the world, just saying, so it's pretty good for them. With Russia being kicked back all the way to here, even losing Tehran, basically. With the puppet of Iran dying as Tehran is captured. But there's one problem with this. That the war looks to be going bad for Russia. So they just assume it does. As they liberate them and make them a country again, like that. But the only problem is that Russia was ready to do this as they moved forces. It looks like Russia's going to lose land, but doesn't look like they're going to lose. Now, look, see at this map? It looks good for Russia. With America coming, with them being able to do something good, they liberate Denmark. Well, I'm pushing the Hungarian puppet back. And they kick Russia out of Czechia. But Russia was ready to sign to invade again. As they push further into Germany. But it looks like here they're actually not doing so well. Especially after they lost Iran, which was a big puppet. So they have lost a lot. With their Xinjiang gains being good, but except for the fact that Japan now starts a new offensive, which is here, and it, with Canadian and American forces arriving, they then do this. And yeah. Well, the last time America invaded Russia, they lost. Because they were helping white forces, and as we know, the white forces did not win. It was Bolsheviks. With that happening, with Canadian forces doing this all by themselves, but really this is not really does nothing, because it doesn't hurt Russia. It just hinders Russia's ability. This area, Siberia, undefended virtually. With Russia hoping to be able to hold on to Manchukuo, they basically set up a defensive in Xinjiang. Eventually here. The only place they're really losing is in the south. And yeah, even in Turkmenistan, they start losing. Well, the Turkmenistan region, eventually, after they take out former Iranian regions. With Russia agreeing to one compromise in Europe if peace, they will leave German lands, Czech lands, Albanian lands. They won't leave those, but they'll leave lands in return for this. They will allow Turkey to gain back former lands in Iran. But this compromise is basically Russia's way of this. Which now let's go to come back after the peace treaty. The Treaty of Moscow. Annex back land. countries in Europe didn't really lose land except Albania. Bulgaria keeps the same amount of land. Norway is a puppet and loses quite a bit of land to Russia, but luckily they managed to keep their alliance, which was very important. But Iraq still gains lands from Iran to make it match the ethnicities better, which means this alliance still lives, but under a lot of restraints, with China and India still able to join, they just need to pay heavy war reparations. Canada getting Alaska, now the map is much better. With that two island, with East Timor and a bit of Indonesia deciding, yeah, we're a part of this alliance. Yeah, I'm going to allow that. And South Korea, which doesn't have any treaty left to sign. But it looks like they're going for the treaty of... Tokyo. But I forgot two things in the Treaty of Moscow. You want to see those two things? So Canada gets to annex these lands. And America gets these lands. And so, these lands are part of this alliance. Which Russia doesn't really like. But I mean, the Xinjiang Republic they were talking about kind of wasn't actually what they meant by helping Xinjiang gain freedom and free from oppression. Oh yeah, this is supposed to be a border. And yeah, I'm making a border now. Xinjiang. So it looks like the Russian Empire has managed to get bigger in this video, but they have also lost a lot of land. But it looks like there's going to be another war, but I don't think I'm going that far. But just remember, Russia is the strongest nation. But it turns out in a treaty they then make after, Germany isn't allowed to join. Which... They basically also stated that Germany can't join, which they kind of meant, I guess. But with the treaty, they then show that as they invade, which not really good. They only made it so they could invade. Ooh. With it looking like they're trying to establish some kind of control over East Germany. And parts of Poland. And I'm going as far as East Germany's border was and saying, yeah, we're ready for peace. Huh. Why do you want all those land? Let's see what the ending of this video was. Very harsh. But then they basically say, oh, the Russian treaty is illegitimate as Russia isn't complying good enough. Is what the world then says, which they... couldn't do anything then because they didn't mark it as illegitimate. But they're looking like Russia's going to annex this East German lands. And that's all for today's video. So now we can go over why you should subscribe. Why should you subscribe? I don't know. Oh yeah, we're trying to get to 175 subscribers by the end of the year. So please like and subscribe. If you subscribe, good things will come your way. That's all for today's video. Please like and subscribe, Wild Mapper.